Steering is one of the safety critical systems on any boat, and the boat owner or marine surveyor needs to know what to look for when checking a rudder. In this video, I'm going to share with you the tools, techniques and tips I use to check whether a rudder is in good condition and if it's safe to use until the vessel's next survey, which could be 5 years away. Hello, I'm David Pestridge of White Hat Marine Surveying, located in the beautiful county of Devon in the United Kingdom. My mission is to help people understand boats better. The approach I take when checking the rudder during a survey on a boat varies according to the material the rudder is constructed from and its design. There are general checks that apply to all rudders and specific checks that are based on the rudder's material or its design. Along with showing you the tools and techniques I use to inspect rudders, towards the end I'll be sharing with you what I think is the most underrated tool in my toolbox, but which I use without fail on every boat survey. Right then, let's get out of business. My rudder survey routine has 8 key elements, and I've added chapters to this video to help you find any sections you wish to focus on or watch again. The first part of any survey on any part of any vessel is to take a minute and engage the Mark 1 eyeball and just look. In this case, look at the rudder from different angles and consider, what is it made of? How is it made? Does it look right for this vessel? There's a world of difference between a 1.5 metre long FRP spade rudder with no skeg, as fitted to a Category A yacht such as a Dealer 39, and an all-welded steel rudder fitted to a narrowboat. Knowing what looks right comes with the experience of seeing lots of rudders on different boats. But we should always start our assessment by asking ourselves, does this rudder look right for this boat? And what checks are critical to us drawing a conclusion on its serviceability? We should make note of what general characteristics the rudder has. Is the rudder balanced, semi-balanced or unbalanced? Does it have a supportive skeg or a part-height protective skeg? Does it have a flat or aerofoil profile? Does the rudder look fair? Is it aligned with the mast on the yacht? Does it look straight? I find that holding up my clipboard's long edge and aligning it with the rudder and mast helps me see if they are in the same plane. For vessels fitted with more than one rudder, we should check that they are a matching pair and are in the same orientation. Now it's time to get our hands on the rudder. And depending on the type of rudder fitted and its age, we can expect wear to occur in the structure of the rudder and its support bearings. We start off by checking for play in all three dimensions, longitudinal, lateral and vertical. And this will require us to physically manipulate the rudder in each of these planes. It's worth having some rag or gloves to minimise the antifoul rubbing off on your hands whilst doing this. The results of this should be recorded in our notes, and in general, we might expect a semi-balanced spade rudder with no skeg to have 2 or 3 millimetres of play, fore and aft, and the same laterally, but very little vertically, whereas a steel rudder supported on a steel skeg on a narrowboat may well have a lot of play in all three planes due to the base of the rudder stock sitting in a steel cup welded to the skeg. And as a general rule, if the play we find equals 10% of the rudder stock diameter, then remedial work should be recommended. Of course, many modern rudders are built around machined, profiled rudder stocks, so wherever possible, measure the rudder stock as close to the point where it enters the rudder as you can. And you'll need a vernier gauge for this. Often you'll need to get inside the lazarette to access the stock as it emerges into the hull if you can't get a reading on top of the rudder itself. My next test is to hit it with a hammer. Percussion testing is a fundamental technique in marine surveying and is applicable to all vessels, types and materials. It's also one of the most widely misunderstood techniques by boat owners, boat brokers and new surveyors. At its heart is a simple concept. When you impart energy into a material through an impact with an object, some of the energy gets returned or bounced back. And this is generally proportionate to the thickness and density of the material being struck. The art of percussion testing is knowing where and how hard to hit with how big a hammer, and then how to interpret the results you get. In the case of an FRP spade rudder, we would use a lightweight hammer with a gentle tapping motion to try and identify hollow areas, areas that have become delaminated, and to help us find blisters and voids within the laminate and structure that are not visible to the naked eye. I generally aim to tap the rudder every 10 centimetres or so, working in a methodical pattern from fore to aft and top to bottom. When something doesn't sound right, I circle it in chalk and then come back to it for further investigation. Moisture testing is a central part of any FRP survey and is conducted with a view to ascertaining how much moisture is present within the hull laminate on any given day. It is by its nature a snapshot of the hull's moisture content, which naturally changes on a daily, monthly and seasonal basis. This part of the rudder survey requires specialist equipment in the form of a moisture meter, and as such, is probably beyond the scope of the prospective boat buyer or owner. The vast majority of FRP rudders on production boats are made up of a metal rudder stock, possibly reinforced with some metal tangs welded onto the stock, which run aft from the stock. This framework is then encapsulated between two shaped FRP mouldings, and the void is filled with closed-cell PVC foam, filler blocks or resin. In time, most rudders built this way take on moisture and may eventually start displaying moisture-related defects or degradation of the internal structure due to corrosion or material breakdown. In a worst-case scenario, the metal structure becomes detached from the filler and therefore the moulding, which usually results in catastrophic failure when loaded. I have two moisture meters in my toolbox, which both have their pros and cons. For more detailed assessment, I rely upon my Sovereign moisture meter, which can work in shallow mode down to about 3 mm, and deep mode, which goes down to about 25 mm. And this can give very useful insights into how much of the moisture is either on the surface or deep within the laminate. Using chalk, I write the shallow and deep readings on the rudder where I took the readings. It's informative to know whether the shallow readings are generally higher or lower than the deep readings. Once the moisture meter has been check calibrated, the method is very similar to percussion testing, albeit with a less dense testing pattern. I aim to take 3 to 10 readings on each side of the rudder in both shallow and deep modes. You can see my chalked numbers on this rudder. I always write the shallow mode number first, or if they're the same, I put a circle around the reading. My next test is to check the range of movement of the rudder. This is an important check, and we want to see if rudder travel is equal to either side of the centre line. We need to understand what mechanism limits the range of this travel, and can we assess the overall functionality of the steering? On a narrowboat, for example, rudder travel is typically limited by the rudder hitting the hull. On a sailing yacht, there may be one of several mechanisms at work, so it's important to know what is fitted. It's not unusual to find a difference of 10% or more in the deflection of the rudder to port and starboard. To measure this is quite simple. Place a chalk line on the hull above the rudder when it's midships, then move the rudder to the extent of its range to port and starboard. Put another chalk line on the hull and then measure the distance from the centre line to these marks in millimetres. You can see a typical set of results in this picture. Now that we know what type of rudder we have and how far it travels, we need to confirm that we understand what limits this travel and is there an effective mechanism to prevent the rudder being damaged when underway in a following sea or when going astern. On tiller steered boats, it's typically the range of movement of the tiller itself before it comes into contact with the cockpit combing, deck winches and so on. On wheel steered vessels, it could be the range of the hydraulic ram which actuates the rudder stock, or there may be fixed stops for wire operated quadrants to come up against. Now, this is straying into the assessment of the vessel steering, which we will look at in more detail later in our survey routine, but for now, we just need to know what limits the travel of the rudder, and is it both balanced and effective. On many vessels, there isn't a great need for cathodic protection of the rudder itself, but it's often used as a carrier for anodes, intended to protect the stern gear as a whole. Anodes need to be of the right material for the intended mooring location of the vessel. Magnesium for freshwater moorings, aluminium for brackish and estuary water, and zinc for seawater. Telling one type of anode from another when part wasted isn't easy, especially if they've been fitted for a while and are not very active. In pre-purchase surveys, it's often worth recommending that, for the relatively small cost involved, they be replaced with quality anodes of the right composition to suit the location where the vessel will be kept. This then gives a datum from which to assess anode wastage at future liftouts. As an interesting aside, anodes should be electrically bonded internally to enable them to protect the most vulnerable metal structures in the boat. This involves connecting the back of the anode to the engine block earthing point, the prop shaft, prop, and any seacocks using quite heavy gauge tinned multi-strand wire. These connections can be checked by putting your multimeter probes onto the prop shaft and to the nearest anode and checking for both continuity and resistance. If none is found and bonding is fitted, the first suspect is the bridging wire, which should be fitted to the flexible coupling, and after that, check for corroded fittings. It's normally beyond the scope of a typical survey to fault find any given defect unless an obvious candidate is noted. I made reference at the start to what I think is the most underrated tool in my toolbox. If you're like me, I'm sure that over time the number of tools in your toolbox just keeps growing, and you find that some only come out on really special occasions, such as litmus paper for testing the pH of osmotic blisters, or your softwood spike for probing rot. However, the one tool I have that comes out of the toolbox without fail on every survey is the Humble Magnet. I use a pair of very strong neodymium magnets and they have a multitude of uses, from holding up my plumb line whilst measuring up on a steelboat to detecting magnetic metals within laminates. They're also invaluable for confirming whether the stainless steel rudderstock or prop shaft is made from higher quality austenitic or lower quality ferritic or martensitic stainless steel, and for helping narrow down the material the propeller or keel is made of. Mine are over 10 years old now and are no longer available, but there is a link in the description below to ones very similar to mine. Just remember, always keep them on their metal keeper plate and away from the ship's compass and your mobile phone. The last thing we need to do after checking the rudder is record our observations in a manner that is quick and easy to do on site, but contains enough detail to help in writing the report when we are back in the office. As an aside, I've always been a fan of writing in pencil on a paper template on a clipboard. It works pretty well even in light rain, it won't run, and it doesn't need batteries. Some surveyors prefer digital templates to save time on writing up. Some use dictaphones with software that generates text from their spoken record. And some surveyors use typists on the other side of the world to write their first draft overnight. My advice is try them all. Find out what works best for you. For sure, pencil and paper is not the most efficient method out there, but it has never let me down. So then, here is the section for rudder inspection from my survey checklist. The template serves a second important purpose beyond just recording my results. It acts as a prompt to remind me to check through everything. As such, it is a living document, and it's changed over time as my technique has improved and my knowledge has deepened. When I started surveying in 2008, my survey checklist was 12 pages long. It now stands at 19 pages, and it keeps growing the more I learn my trade. Here are what my notes might look like after checking a typical FRP spade rudder on a yacht. Hope you enjoyed watching this video. If you learned something new, then why not support the channel by buying me a beer using the link in the banner. Thanks for watching. I'll see you all next time.